Hi, I'm Jim Hudson. Today we're going to talk about the operation of the TCX51C Tire Changer. Now I have a 20-inch truck tire here ready to change. We're going to do this one first. Now although this is a center clamp tire changer, I do have the same three-way adjustable power outside shovel that I have on the other TCX changers in our lineup. So lots of power, lots of adjustability, that nice fingertip control. I have the optional wheel lift equipped on this machine as well. Going to be working with some fairly heavy tire and wheel assemblies today, so that makes life a lot easier to have that lift there. So on my wheel here in particular has a fairly small center bore, but I do have some additional clamping cones that come with the machine. So I'm just going to go ahead and pop off the larger one and snap on a slightly smaller clamping cone here that better fits the center bore of this wheel. Give that clamp about a quarter turn down to the right, lock it in, and then just kind of snug up my handles to tighten the wheel. Other than that, it's a standard swing arm levered type of tire changer. Very simple operation, very durable. The TCX51C, though, has some tricks up its sleeve. So on these fairly large truck tires, I have found that most of the time it's easier to just push off the bottom bead with the roller rather than kind of get in there and fish around with the bar to try to get these larger, heavier beads demounted, the bottom beads in particular. It's easier just to push them off with the disc, so I'll do that in this case. Get my disc out of the way and give it some bead lube here. So that lower roller trick with the locking demount disc, you know, obviously that's not just for 19.5s. It'll work on any wheel and tire, as you'll see here on a few of the other assemblies we'll work on. All right, get it ready to go back on. I have a decal up here on my swing arm that lets me know where to set the TPMS, you know, what the best practice is to locate that, prevent it from getting damaged. And of course my upper acting bead press help keep that tire track in the drop center all the way around. All right, got it mounted up. But I can tell already that I'm going to have some issues maybe getting this tire to take air. Now I've got a really, really large gap over here. I'm going to be hard-pressed to pull on this tire to get it to take air. Obviously that isn't something I want to kind of struggle with for very long. This tire changer has FastBlast on it, so all we need to do is bring this nozzle down into position, you know, an inch or so, inch, maybe 2 inches away from the wheel, lock it down, press down on the second stage of this pedal. So I can hands-free, I can blast inflate this tire. It would have been a fairly large inflation challenge, made very, very fast and easy with this fast blast. I want to stay on that pedal to make sure I keep feeding air through the chuck to make sure the tire doesn't fall right back off the wheel. Go ahead and seat up the beads. All right, let's look at a different truck tire here now. This one is off of a Sprinter, so I've got a particularly large center bore on a steel wheel. Something I can still very easily handle though, and I'll show you how. Bead breaking is obviously the same. I'm gonna use my power outside shovel here. But since I have this really large center bore, I'm going to employ my large bore clamping kit. So I've got a few pieces with this. I'll talk about a few of them here. The first one I'm going to put down is actually this riser plate. So this is just going to kind of help get my stack height up a little bit, since a lot of times these wheels have a very deep offset. They sit naturally very low on the tire changer. So I'm just going to put it up to a little bit more of a comfortable working height for me. Sometimes you can also employ this riser plate on a very, very wide, just a naturally wide, wide wheel that sits low on the platen as well. So after that, I'll throw on my platen extender here. I want to make sure I line up my grooves with the three that are in the riser plate. I can go ahead and lift this into place. Got a traction pin I'll need to line up, just like I normally would on my my standard platen. And this large diameter center bore clamping cone that I'll put down in place of my smaller cone I had on from earlier. We're going to kind of go on the opposite end of the size range here in terms of center bore. Clamp it up. Once it's clamped, though, you'll see basically the tire changing process itself doesn't change very much at all from a standard tire. I'm going to want to, you know, check my TPMS position, make sure I'm not about to break that. Lever the beads off, kind of like I normally would on any tire and wheel. This is a fairly narrow tire. I can go ahead and just kind of lever that bottom bead off. Put some bead lube on here. Back on. Again, kind of minding my TPMS position. If I have to set that, I'll kind of bring that around and set it where I need. Certain cases I might want to use my bead press. In this case, I can see it's tracking the drop center really well on its own. That wing really helps with that naturally. And I'm ready to go ahead and inflate. All right, let's really switch gears here and talk about a high-performance wide tire. The first thing I'm going to want to do, since I know this is this wheel's wider than 10 inches, I'll move my side shovel to the wide wheel setting here. Gives me a little better angle of attack to handle these wider wheels. Otherwise, I'll come in and go ahead and break my bead like normal. Making sure I stay away from my TPMS. Three-way adjustability really helps me precisely control this shovel on these high-dollar assemblies. Really like having that level of control. One more break here. All right. Right, so one thing I'm going to do here, I talked about the riser plate on the large bore kit. This large bore kit's actually fairly versatile. Completely different application here, obviously, but I'm still going to use that riser characteristic on this wheel. So I'll go ahead and put my riser plate down, put my platen extender down, but since the center flange of this wheel is small, it's not going to sit flat on this high diameter platen extender. So I'll put in this little middle insert that takes up that gap. Now essentially what I've done is I have the same dimensions as my normal platen, it's just about 2 inches higher. Kind of gets it to a little more comfortable working height and gives you necessary clearance at the lower end of the bead where you sometimes need it. Otherwise, I got my standard red clamping cone back on my quick clamp shaft here. So from here though, again, the tire changing process itself is fairly similar. I've got a bead press arm that I can use to kind of manipulate the tire into the drop center if I need. I can use it as a lifting device as well. Again, kind of watching my TPMS position. But again, instead of trying to lever my bottom bead over with this bar, this tire is almost as wide as the bar itself. So I use this disc trick here. Since this lower disc locks, I can demount with it. So not necessarily a heavy tiring wheel, but just very, very wide. Still a lot easier just to push it off with this disc than struggle inside there with the bar. Go ahead and give it some bead lube here. Get ready and go back on. This particular tire can just kind of push that bottom bead on. Sometimes you can use that as a shortcut. Top bead though, I'm going to want to make sure again that I'm keeping that tire tracking the drop center all the way around. So as I'm mounting up, I'm going to want to be under that wing, over the leading edge, and use my press arm to keep that tire in the drop center where it needs to be. Use first speed. First speed is nice and slow. Push my bead off the mounting knob there. So you've got all the tools you need to mount up even performance car tires, wide tires like this, especially with the help of that clamping kit. All right, let's check out how to handle a reverse mount assembly. So this is a reverse wheel. Obviously, I'll have to mount it upside down then on the platen. I'll do that using a flange plate here, and I'll show you how that looks. All right. So what I want to do is preset my flange plate in the front face of the wheel so that I can guarantee that I'm not going to damage the front face of this nice chrome wheel with it upside down on the tire changer. I have a couple bolts here that I'll put through the back side. Just finger tight. They don't have to be really tight because all they do is just hold the flange plate into position while I get everything clamped up. All right, I have three traction dowels here on the bottom of this flange plate that I'll line up with the slots in the platen. So just kind of rotate until I can feel those drop in real nice and snug. Now obviously I have a very high, tall stack height here now on this. So what that can do is it can actually cause me to not have enough clearance to change this tire. So not be able to bring my head in far enough. I need to get this stack height lower. I can do that with a different set of pins, and I'll show you what that looks like. All right, so I have my shorter flange plate pins now installed on my flange plate. So these are about an inch and a half or so shorter than the standard length pins. So let's see if that gives us enough stack height here to actually lower this assembly low enough to get it to change. Now with the shorter pins, I do want to make sure that I don't come in and they're too short such that, you know, the flange plate itself contacts the front face of the wheel first. So, you know, I always want to make sure the pins themselves are contacting the lug holes first. Again though, I'll go ahead and run in my bolts kind of finger tight here, just to hold that flange plate into position while I'm mounting everything up. Bring up my flange plate and my wheel all at the same time here. Just kind of rotate this until I feel those three dowels kind of fall down into those channels. Now, with that lower, I've gained the height that I need on the low end to go ahead and change this tire. So I can go ahead and clamp against the inside of the bore as I would normally here with the quick clamp. As on our, really on any other tire changer, reverse wheels pose a clamping challenge, but not necessarily a tire changing challenge. All the same steps still apply. Now, since the stack height is very high and I got a fairly wide wheel and tire, I'm gonna again use my disc to demount this bottom bead. But what you'll notice is, again, I sort of run out of height here at the top range of travel. I have an adjustment here, though, in this disc. I can pull this pin, I can move this whole disc up a little bit to gain that travel at the max height. Method's the same, though. Bring that roller up, bring it in just a little bit, indent it, and just give it some rotation and push off that bottom bead. Again, very, very useful trick. And my demount disc has got an adjustment built into it to handle those situations whether you need the disc acting at the extreme bottom end or the extreme top end of the machine's capability. All right. Bottom beads are fairly straightforward. Top beads, though, are as they are on any normal drop center wheel. You're going to want to keep the tire tracking in the drop center all the way around. So I'll just want to keep an eye on that. Use my bead press. Go ahead and get it mounted up. So as you can see, we have done now four very different assemblies, from truck tires to sprinter tires, and even now aftermarket reverse wheels. So very capable machine with some different tips and tricks and accessories thrown in there. For more information on our other tire changers, visit hunter.com. Thanks for watching.